Thank you so much, all the attendees. Hello and welcome to I'm the Best Mom. I hope you all are keeping well and staying safe. In this special edition of Every Day is Mother's Day, we are celebrating motherhood journey every day. And motherhood journey is of many, many memorable experiences. It's a beautiful transition with many milestones. And learning the milestone on time can help us understand and be prepared what to come in all stages of motherhood journey. And every mother put the best to raise the child in the best possible way. But it do have a lot of challenges, the wins. And in this overpowering journey of motherhood, a mom has many questions, but not enough answer. This is where we come in. I'm the best mom. Today, we are going to talk a beautiful topic, which can be a lot of concern for many parents. And it's how to identify normal and abnormal moments in children. To address this, we are honored to have Dr. Minal Garg with us today. She is a consultant pediatric neurologist at Surya Hospital, Jaipur, and she is an expert in the domain. Many times we have come across children exhibit many types of normal moments during their development, and when they cross their milestone. But today, we will be learning more in detail from Dr. Minal. Thank you so much, Dr. Minal, for coming to I'm the Best Mom.
Thank you for inviting me.
So, ma'am, please initiate this session with your thoughts, and how often you come across this kind of challenges, though you are a specialized doctor in pediatric neurology, but many times the red flags, the pediatrician may come across, and they also... And I think in any concern related to the child, the mother plays a very, very important role because she's the one who sees these challenges with the child at the first go. Many times it may be a belief that everything is fine, but sometimes we lose the time. And need to act right on time is very, very important. Exactly. Am I right?
Yes, exactly.
So, ma'am, over to you. Please share to our attendees. And I request all the attendees, if you have any specific question which you will be learning during the session today, please post it on the Q&A session. We will take it. Ma'am, you would like to present any? Yeah, sure.
Okay, so thank you so much for having me. And I welcome everyone who has joined us and who is listening to us. Am I audible?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Sure. So I'll just, without further ado, I will just start my presentation. So let me just introduce myself. I'm Dr. Minal Garg. I'm working as a consultant pediatric neurologist at Surya Hospital, Jaipur. I've trained in pediatrics, and after that, I've done my fellowship in pediatric neurology and epilepsy from Mumbai. So today I'm going to be talking about something that is very practical, not a lot of theory, not a lot of preaching. So something that is very practical, that is how to identify normal and abnormal movements in your child. So it is something that should be known to everybody who is involved in any way in taking care of children, or even if you come in contact with children anywhere. So I'm just calling them movements for the sake of generalization, for the sake of ease of talking. Sometimes they may be movements, they may be called paroxysms, they may be called episodes. So these type of things, these type of movements, episodes, they happen during the development of any normal child. So sometimes parents or caretakers may feel that a certain movement, it seems a little suspicious to them, but they're very confused. Is this a normal movement or is this abnormal? If it is abnormal, should I see someone? Should I see a doctor? And who should I consult? Who is the right person who will be able to guide me? So most often what parents do is they end up asking their neighbor or grandparents or some relatives or somebody, and things are lost a little bit in translation and while propagating. So the question comes that why do these kind of movements, these episodes, why do they happen? So many of them are physiological. That means they are normal. They are a part of the normal development. They may be caused by infections, metabolic conditions, autoimmune conditions. That means a whole host of diseases may cause them, which may be simple or complex diseases. If your child already has a diagnosis of a neurological or developmental disorder, then he or she is more likely to have these kind of abnormal or rather suspicious movements. And lastly, they can be seizures. So seizure means fits, means Dora or Mirgi or epilepsy. So they can be that also. We think that we'll be very easily able to recognize seizures. A child will roll his or her eyes upwards. The body will start shaking. But all seizures in children do not look like that. So we'll be talking about that a little more. So many such movements, they will disappear with time. They will go away. They will require no treatment. But some of them might need treatment. Some of them might need intervention. Often because parents don't know, they will miss these movements and they will present to us quite late when the disease or something is advanced further. Or on the opposite side, for benign movements, they will do a lot of testing. They will do directly some MRI or something and then they will come to me or to any other pediatric neurologist or to any doctor. So if you feel that these movements have become disruptive, the child is not functioning well at home or at school, then a pediatric neurologist will help you to recognize these movements and to guide the treatment in a proper direction. So I'm not going to be talking a lot. I'm going to be showing you a lot of videos of abnormal movements. Many of these are home videos brought by parents, or there are some videos which I have taken in the hospital. So these movements will show what I'm talking about, whether a movement is normal or abnormal, and how to identify it. So just starting with this first movement. So this is a small baby, around 1 month old child. As you can see that this child is sleeping. So he seems to be having some jerking movements. His hands are moving, his head, his neck is moving. And you can see the parent removes the blanket because the legs of the child also moves. So while sleeping, he's having these jerky movements that are there happening frequently and the parents are really worried. This is a second child, again with the same kind of movement. This is a newborn child, only a few days old. He's sleeping on his tummy. And the mom has taken this video because the child seems to be shaking. So he's jerking his whole chest, his tummy, his head is moving. Even his hands seem to be moving. And if we see the video a little more, so again, this movement is happening. And you will notice both of these children, they are sleeping at the time. So this is a very common movement that is observed by parents. Many parents come with these kind of complaints. So what are these movements in young children? Neonates. That means newborns and little older children. So that is something which is very common. It is known as benign sleep myoclonus in infants and neonates. So sleep myoclonus actually is a normal movement which can happen at any age. It can happen with adults also. But they are much more common in newborns, much more common till the first 6 months of age. Because parents like to look at their children sleeping. They will notice and pick up these movements and get very worried. So there is a jerky movement of the limbs, trunk or whole body. They occur only during sleep, and there is an important thing that as soon as you wake up the child, the movement will go away. It will never happen in awake state. So they decrease with age, they slowly go away. Often they are confused with seizures. Even, you know, sometimes physicians may mistake these movements for seizures. Parents usually get an EEG, get an MRI, and by the time they come to me, sometimes they are already on anti-seizure medication. And now the catch here is that anti-seizure medication can actually increase these movements. It can worsen them. Normally, these movements happen in all children. They go away with time. They do not need any investigation. They do not need any treatment. So this is something which is known as benign sleep myoclonus. So let's move to another video. This is a little older child, around 6 months. Let me just play the video here. So young child, 6 months old, she's sitting. Suddenly she looks a little, you know, afraid. She will just do this jerking movement. Let me play it again. So she just has a little bit of a tremor. She looks a little afraid, or like she's afraid of something. Again, she has done this and it lasts only for a few seconds here.
You click it on the screen.
So this is a movement which is known as a shuddering attack. So these are again benign. Benign means normal events which can occur in infancy, in younger children, usually around 1 year of age or less. So there is a rapid shivering movement of the head, shoulder and the trunk and maybe of the hands. They last for a few seconds and then they go away. So again, these movements may look like seizures. They may be investigated a lot. The child may be on treatment, but these are normal movements. These are known as shudder attacks, and they will go away with time. The important thing is then when you see the child, she's fully conscious, she's playful, she doesn't look at all bothered by these events. They come and go, but she's doing her normal activity. Now showing you another movement, this is a little older child, around 2 years old. So when you see her, she seems to be pressing her legs together. She's pushing herself into the sofa. She's pressing her hands also. But when the father is calling her, or mother is calling, she's responding. So then she will go back to the movement, but when she's called, she will respond. She looks absolutely conscious, but she's, you know, very involved with the movement. Now showing you a little more obvious example of this, 3-year-old boy. So you can see the child is just pressing himself into the bed. He's very involved, but when the father calls him, he looks back, he smiles, and then goes back to his normal movement. Again, the father is calling him, he's responding, and then he goes back and starts doing it all over again. So this is a movement, this is an episode which is known as self-gratification. So it is a normal behavioral variant, and it is a form of masturbatory behavior in young children. So often it looks like the child is having some abdominal pain, he's having a seizure. And along with this movement, child can also have redness of the face, they can have sweating, and they can keep on doing this movement again and again. So this is a normal variant which can happen in this phase of the age group. Usually it occurs in children older than 1 year and goes away by 3 or 4 years of age. So it is frequently associated with, you know, boredom, excess of emotion, excitement. And if the child is bored, there is lack of stimulation. And when the parent comes to us, one of this is a clinic video and the other you can see is a home video. So video is really helpful for diagnosis because the child might not do it when he or she is in the clinic. So when we tell the parents that it's a form of masturbatory behavior, sometimes parents feel very ashamed that the child, what has, you know, the doctor told us, a child could not be doing something like this. So this is not something which the child is doing consciously or with a bad intent. It is a normal movement which occur in this phase of life, and they usually go away with age. Scolding or hitting the child is not the solution. There is no medication for this. The treatment is to distract the child very gently when he or she is doing this and to divert their attention. And slowly they will go away. Now showing you another child. This is a little older child, around 4 years of age. So the child is moving his hands. He's flapping his hands, moving his head, going around in circles. So I think all of us must have seen these movements in our children. So this is a movement that father is trying to hold the child here. So this is a movement which is known as a stereotypy. So they are purposeless, you know, rhythmic movements in children. They occur very frequently in children who are younger than 3 years of age. So the child may express their emotions like this. They will flap the arms. They will do a hand flapping, arm flapping. They will nod their head, or they will just rock like this. So if they are occurring infrequently, or when the child is happy or excited, and they're occurring in younger children, then they may be normal movements. But if they are occurring very frequently, the child seems to be lost in his or her world, or there is developmental delay, then they can be a sign of a developmental disorder such as autism. So if you feel the signs that I've listed, very frequent, multiple types, developmental delay, then you need to see a doctor for these movements so that a proper diagnosis can be made. But if they occur infrequently in young children, they are normal and they will go away as the child matures. So another episode, another paroxysm. So you can see the child here.
It's okay.
So you can see the child.
Mom, he's doing it again.
Blue in the face. He seems to be crying, but there is no sound coming.
It's okay.
And the child keeps on doing it. There is no sound. He's turning blue. And now he starts having a sort of a seizure. Now he's having a full-blown seizure. So this is a movement which is known as a breath-holding spell. They are benign. They are developmental problems that occur in children from around 6 months to usually 4 to 5 years of age. How do these movements start? The child is fine, and then suddenly he's either hurt, he hurts himself, he's hit by someone or someone has scolded the child. The child starts crying and then he or she will hold his or her breath. The crying will stop and the face will turn either blue or white. So they are of two types, blue or white, that is cyanotic and pallid breath holding spells. If the breath holding spell goes on for a little longer time, it can lead to an anoxic seizure. But these are not epileptic seizures. This is not Mirgi. This is not Fitz in the true sense of the word. They are developmental problems. So anti-seizure medicine, that is medicine for seizures, is not needed for these events. So usually we don't do any MRI, any EEG. We just do a blood test and there is medicine to treat it if these episodes are very frequent. And the children, they try to, you know, emotionally manipulate their parents sometimes by using these episodes. They can consciously hold their breath for some time. So parents have to be very strict, you know, they have to be a little more aware that they are not, you know, kind of blackmailed, and they should not pay a lot of attention when the child is having these episodes. So this is another child, normal child around 15 months old. So grandma is calling the child. She wants to come. She wants to play, but she doesn't want to get up. She doesn't want to crawl. So what she's doing is she's just moving on her bottom. So she's moving very fast when she wants to move. Yeah. So she's moving very nicely. She's otherwise very interactive. She's playful. She's responding and she's moving very rapidly when she wants to. So this is something which is known as bottom shuffling. So what do babies do? They sit on their bottoms. They will move themselves using their legs and sometimes their arms, but they will not crawl. They don't want to sit. They don't want to stand. So she's laughing. She's very happy about it. So these children, usually they don't have a neurological disorder. They are late walkers. They start walking around 18 months of age or even later, but they do improve with time. So if the child is doing this persistently, you have to help the child, you know, to achieve their balance in standing and in walking. You can take the help of a physiotherapist, but usually they start walking around 18 months of age. Now coming to this very different thing, this is something which many of you may have seen. So the child bears his or her weight on toes, but not on the entire foot. So this is known as toe walking. So in younger children, when they just start walking, toe walking can be normal. Later on, it can be a sign of a neurological problem, an orthopedic, that is a problem which is related to bones and tendons. It can be a developmental issue. For example, in autism, toe walking is very common. So if the child is doing it after he or she has started walking nicely, even then they are doing it, it is increasing or persistently, the child is always walking in this toe walking fashion, then you need to see a pediatric neurologist or a doctor, because they will be able to diagnose and treat it in time. The earlier it is diagnosed, the better the treatment and the more easier the treatment then rather than diagnosing it later. Now, I'm showing you a little different kind of a movement. This is a young child around 4 or 5 months old. So did you see? She just had a jerk. She just did this. And now the child does not look, you know, very active. She doesn't look happy. She doesn't look playful. Probably she's not even looking at her mother so nicely. And around right now, so she did this again. So this is happening again and again. And she does this movement. Again, this is a home video. Let me show you another home video made by parents. So another young child just starting to crawl, and here he just falls, his head goes down. He's trying to get up again. Again, he's falling. And this is happening again and again. So this is the complaint with which the parents came. So these movements, it can look like the child is just having an abdominal pain, or he's not able to hold his head and he's just, you know, not maintaining balance. But actually these are seizures. So these kind of jerks or myoclonus in infants, rarely they can be normal, but most likely they are seizures. So they need a test which is known as EEG and possibly an MRI for diagnosis. And in most cases, they require medication. They're very easy to miss. Parents come very late because they keep on thinking that he's not maintaining balance or this will go away, but it will likely not go away and you need to see a doctor very urgently. So I'm showing you another kind of an episode now. Let me just forward this a bit. So now this child is having some sort of an episode, just staring blankly, he's blinking, he's not responding. Even if you call his name, he won't respond. Just seems to be staring off into space, and now he's sort of coming back a little. It's only a few seconds, and now he's thinking that, okay, something has happened. He's had his awareness back, and now he's looking. Another child, similar problem. So he's staring, just seems to be a little uncomfortable. And then he doesn't realize that something has happened. He starts blowing it again. So this is something which is known as an absence seizure. So these are common children seizures which usually happen only in children. They look like that the child is just blanking out or staring for a few seconds. So I've made these children to blow on the paper, because in the clinic it's easier, because the seizure can be brought about if the child keeps on blowing. But normally they will not happen when the child is blowing a paper. They will happen normally. They will not happen many times during a day. So parents and even teachers, they think that the child is daydreaming. He or she's not paying attention in the class. And that is the complaint with which many parents come, that he or she doesn't pay attention. He will just blank out and look into space. But these are absence seizures which go away with age, but they require medicine for a few years, and diagnosis can be made with an EEG. Now, since I'm talking about seizures, let me show you another few videos. These are all around 2 or 3 videos of seizures, how seizures can look very differently in children. So this child, he's talking very slowly. And then he has a jerk. And then he goes back to talking very normally, because he doesn't realize that something has happened. So this is another girl. So this clearly looks like a seizure. This very obviously looks like a seizure. Right side of her face is twitching. She seems a little unaware of what is happening, and it keeps on twitching. So this is something which is known as a focal seizure. Very difficult to miss. You'll be easily able to pick that up. Anybody would think that likely it looks like a seizure. But seizures can also look like this. So this child, she looks a little blank. She's picking at the bed sheet. Her mother is calling her. She's not giving any response. And she just moves her arms a little. She moves her head. Her hands seem to be trembling a little. So this is very difficult. This doesn't look like a seizure. You wouldn't think if you see this child that she's having a seizure. But again, these movements were happening again and again, especially at night, and the child looked blank. So the parents eventually brought her to me for treatment. Now moving on, these are now not seizures. They are a different kind of movements. All of you must have seen this kind of movement somewhere. So what this child will do, she will move her head a little. Then she will move her shoulders. She will move her face. So she's moving her eyebrows, she's shrugging her shoulders, she's moving her face again. She's blinking her eyes a lot. Another video of the same child. So she's just lying in the bed, but then she moves her eyebrows, she moves her neck. Again, she moves her neck, she moves her shoulder now. Again, she moves her neck. She just can't stop herself. She's trying to stop, but she's not even aware what is happening, and she just moves it. So this is something which are known as tics. So all of us, many of us have one tic or the other. When we are sitting, we might be, you know, moving our knee or moving our leg, or we might be doing this again and again. So throat clearing. So all of these are little tics. So these are repetitive muscle movements. They result in, you know, sudden and very difficult to control. It's like a jolt, or it's like something like a sound. So they're very common in childhood. They can even occur in adulthood, but they're more common in children. They can occur due to stress, anxiety, you know, any excess of emotion, tiredness, excitement, happiness. If they are occurring very infrequently, or if they're occurring at home or when the child is relaxed, if they're not causing any problems, we do not treat these. But if they persist, if they become very troublesome, then they might, you know, even cause emotional problems, social problems, difficulty in fitting in. They might cause discomfort, pain, and they may interfere with the daily activities. So these kind of tics, which are very frequent, they are associated with diagnoses such as chronic tic disorder or Tourette syndrome. And then they might need treatment. And then as the child goes into adulthood, they become less, and they might not need treatment later on. But children may require treatment. not due to the ticks themselves, but due to the effects that they are causing. Now, this is a child who was admitted with ARDS in the hospital. You can just see how the child is walking. It's looking very, you know, there's a lot of imbalance. The father is trying to hold the child. He's thinking that the child may fall. And he's moving here and there. He doesn't look, you know, very stable. So this kind of movement is known as ataxia. So these are imbalance, incoordinated movements. There can be even problems with speech. There can be stumbling. They can be falling. And the child looks as if he or she is drunk. That's the way you would describe this kid. So in children, it can often appear suddenly. It can be episodic. That means it comes and goes away. Or it can be chronic. That means it appears and keeps on increasing. And always this needs evaluation. This needs treatment. So this is something which is an abnormal movement. Now let me show you now. So this child looks very uncomfortable. His eyes are not still. His hand is moving. His leg is moving. His head is moving. Everything seems to be moving. And he's not comfortable. He looks very uncomfortable. Looks like he's dancing actually. So this is something which is known as opsoclonus myoclonus syndrome. It is also known as dancing eyes and dancing feet syndrome. Initially, it may not look like much. The child is doing, aise kar raha hai, it might go away. But this is a rare syndrome which needs urgent treatment. It requires urgent medication. It may be associated with secondary problems such as a tumor. And if you see this movement, you should bring your child immediately to a hospital. So now let me show you another movement. This is another child. The child is lying, but his hands and feet seem to be moving just a little bit. Hands are moving, hips are moving, chest is moving, feet are moving. Everything is moving just a little bit. So this is a movement which is known as scoria. It may be difficult to, you know, identify in the initial stages. So they are unpredictable, irregular muscle movements. It looks like you are very restless. You are very fidgety. Can be caused by a number of disorders. I will not go into the details of that. But there is medication available to treat scoria as well as to treat the cause which is causing this. Now, showing you a little something which is different. So this is a child sitting in his mother's lap. So the child is trying to move his hand in a particular direction, but the hand is moving in a different direction. He's trying to hold the pen. His hand goes here, it goes there, but it just won't hold the pen. Again, with the other hand. He's fully conscious, but he's just not able to hold the pen. Now let's see this child.
Good morning.
So this is a very intelligent, very articulate and bright child. But the same thing is happening with her mouth and her face. Speech is very unclear. She's not able to say what she's trying to say.
Good morning. Namaste, principal ma'am.
So this is something which is known as dystonia. It is difficult to miss. You won't be able, I mean, it's not like you will not recognize this movement. I mean, you will not think that this is something normal. So this is something which is an involuntary muscle contraction. It causes an abnormal posture. It can happen in one part of the body. It can happen with your hand when you're trying to write. It can happen with your feet, with your face, or it can happen with your entire body. So this can be accompanied by tremors, that is some shivering or other abnormal neurological symptoms, can be caused by a variety of neurological disorders. And there is treatment such as medication, Botox injections, and surgery to help treat it. Now, I think I will just coming to the end. These are the last two videos. So this child, an older child, around 15 years of age, and parents came with the complaint that he's having seizures. So this happens every day around 10 or 11 p.m. when they're just about to sleep. So the child does this movement. He moves his head. Then he's okay for some time. And then again, he will start moving his head. So again, he's moving his head. So this is another child around 10 years old. So this was the complaint. The child will just lift his leg. He will do some abdominal movement. He will do a jerk. But he's absolutely conscious. He's talking to me. And when I ask him to show the movement, he's doing it again and again. So I ask him, show me how does it happen? And he's doing it again and again. So both of these children, they had been to a number of doctors. They were taking anti-seizure medication. They had done a lot of tests. But these movements are actually not seizures. They are something which is known as a functional or a psychogenic event. So functional does not mean that the child is faking his or her symptoms. It's not like he's doing it on purpose. They can be very distressing, very disabling to the child, but they are not seizures. They are not organic movements. They can be caused by various stressors. They can be caused by psychogenic factors, but they will not go away with anti-seizure medication. So the tests will show nothing because there is no organic cause that why these movements are happening. They are happening due to psychogenic factors. We also call it as non-epileptic attack disorder. So it's very difficult for parents to believe that this movement is not, you know, a seizure. It is a functional movement. They don't want to believe that. It can be treated. It can be treated with medication, with therapy, with counseling, but not with anti-seizure medication. So we have to recognize that sometimes all of these movements, they may not have a neurological aspect to them. So I've shown you a lot of videos. Now we are very confused. Everything looks like every other thing. How will we recognize? How will we know which movement is, you know, abnormal, which is normal? When to see a doctor? So I'm journalizing the whole thing a little bit. When should you see a doctor? A movement is very frequent. It is happening very frequently, happening regularly and increasing with time. The child is accompanying developmental delay. So he's not achieving the milestones in time. He's not walking, sitting or speaking when he or she should be doing it. Or he's losing what he's already learned. He used to walk, but now he can't. He used to speak sentences and now he's speaking only single words. There is some alteration in consciousness. The child is drowsy, he's sleepy, or he's unconscious at the time of this movement. Then that is a red flag. There, when since the time the movements have started, you've noticed a change in the behavior or the sleep pattern. The child is sleeping too much. He or she is sleeping too little. It's become very aggressive, very irritable. All of these are abnormal signs. There is an interference with the normal routine. Like I said, in case of tics, for example, if the child is not able to do his or her regular work, then that is the time to see a doctor. It is interfering with the capacity of the child to learn something new or with his school performance, with his academics, then that is a red flag sign. Or if you think that there are some psychological issues that can be happening due to, you know, the distress of having this movement, social problems, mental problems. So in that case, you should see a doctor. So just to conclude, we know that many abnormal movements, many episodes, many paroxysms can happen in children. They may be very difficult for parents to identify. So this leads to the parents coming to the doctor late. They lead to, you know, delayed treatment or difficult treatment, because it would have been better if we had started treatment earlier. So consider a specialist, especially a pediatric neurologist, to help guide you to decide whether this thing is normal, it is abnormal, does it need any treatment, does it need any investigation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Meenal. And while you were presenting, ma'am, can you remove the slide?
Yeah.
So while we were going through the presentation, be it with tic disorder or maybe ataxia or maybe Parkinsonism or any other neurological challenges which you see, but for a mother, it is many times she do not want to accept there is something wrong with my child.
Exactly.
So again, coming back to the red flag, and what is that particular age? Because we are seeing the video starting from maybe a few weeks to maybe at the teenage. So
right,
it's pretty long time, and we should be very, very, now I'm sure people are a little bit worried to understand which one is normal and which is absolutely need to be taken care of. Very seriously, reach out to a pediatric neurologist.
Right.
And we are seeing a lot of questions in and around the concern areas as well. So ma'am, please.
So the first question, I will just read out the questions and try to answer them. So the first question is by Ms. Charul, that my baby girl is 27 months old, but she can't speak and walk. So Charul, this is definitely, there is a developmental delay. By 2 years, a child should be able to say phrases. he or she should be able to walk and even run quite comfortably. And children may even start climbing stairs with support. So that is a definite red flag sign. So this kind of a developmental delay can have many, many causes. So without seeing the child, obviously it is not possible to say what kind of a problem the child is having. So I think the right person that you should see is a pediatric neurologist. They will be able to, you know, guide you in the right direction. What is the cause and how to go about it. So definitely there is a developmental delay and you need to see a doctor urgently.
And ma'am, there is a question from Neha Chaudhary. She's asking, my child is 7 years old. When we play song or anything with a high volume, he gets scared and severe. So why he do so and what I'm supposed to do?
Right. So what happens is a 7-year-old child, normally he or she should not be scared and should not shiver when a song is played. So it does not seem like it is something which is normal. So it can be due to sensitivity to a sound, or it can be because the child is having difficulty adapting to this particular social situation. Again, this can happen in some neurodevelopmental disorders, and we will need to see and examine the child to guide the treatment. Occasionally, it may happen that the child is just, you know, it is just habitual, or he or she doesn't just want to, he or she is not comfortable with the sound. If all the other things are normal, neurological examination is normal, development is normal, behavior is normal, but this does seem like a sign which needs evaluation. So I would say one of the causes can be autism. So it might not be full-blown autism. It might just be an autistic trait. And you need to see a developmental pediatrician or a pediatric neurologist for that.
There's a question from Mr. Jawahar, and he's asking, there are some kids who walk on while they're sleeping. So what we should be doing and what you should be looking at?
Yeah, so sleepwalking, it is a kind of a sleep disorder. Right. So sometimes it goes away with age. If it happens very infrequently, then we might not even need treatment for that. But if it is happening very frequently, then we need to look at a few issues. What is the quality of the sleep? Is there any other problem that is associated with the sleep? And very rarely there are some kind of seizures, which is known as frontal lobe seizures, that can happen in this way, where the child might have hyperkinetic movements. So an EEG or a polysomnography are the tests which may be required to diagnose the exact problem. If they're normal, or if it feels that the problem is happening very infrequently, we may not need to treat it. But if a problem is picked up, it can be treated.
Thank you, ma'am. So you were addressing the question with a 7-year child who gets scared, now there is another question which is there with a 6 months, will just turn 6 next month.
Yeah.
So similar concern with the firecrackers and the darkness and the insect, the child gets scared.
So this is normal. In a young child, in a 6-month-old child, it can be absolutely normal. Everything is new for them. The whole environment is new for them. And they are just adapting to this. A 6-month-old child, by and large, if it was a term baby, he or she should be able to sit with support now, hold their head nicely, respond to their name. When their name is called, they know that it is my name being called, and they look in that direction and reach out with a single hand to take an object. If the development is normal, then you haven't got anything to be worried about. If there is some concern with the development, then you should see a doctor. But by and large, at 6 months, this is normal behavior.
Thank you. So when these are the concerns happening, and be it at any age, now there is another question coming from Vinay Sharma. He's asking, my baby girl, 6 years old, and she is doing eye and face billing. Eyes and face billing.
Billing.
Vinayji, I think you need to specify what exactly you want to convey. So
I think they might be saying blinking.
Oh, could be. Yeah.
Yeah. So if it is blinking,
frequent blinking, could be.
Yeah. So if she's doing it with both her eyes, something like this and something like this, then it might be a tick. As I said, so these ticks can be normal in younger children. So occasional tics we don't treat, just try to observe how these tics are happening. Make the child aware of that. And if the child does it at home or when he or she is relaxed, there is nothing to worry about. If they keep on increasing with time, start happening, you know, at various places, and they are distressing and they're causing problem to the child, then they might need to be treated. Just keep a watch right now. If she's just doing a few ticks, then nothing to be worried about.
Okay. Now, there is another question. The name is anonymous, but let's take this question. My child is 26 months, runs, plays, climbs stairs, etc., but doesn't talk. Says a few words, shows emotions like anger, happiness, but does not follow instructions. Are treating him for an arachnoid cyst?
Okay, so arachnoid cyst is a normal benign variant. It does not cause these symptoms, first of all. Right, so arachnoid cyst is picked up when we do MRI for any other cause, it might be picked up. So first of all, arachnoid cyst, I don't think is connected to these symptoms at all. Secondly, what you are telling me is that the child has something which is known as social language delay. So the motor development is normal, but the social language development is lagging behind. So for social language delay, one of the major causes is autism. So I think you need to see a pediatric neurologist or a developmental pediatrician to rule out autism in your child. It might be just the beginning or it might be an autistic trait, but that is what we are looking for.
Right. Ma'am, any message for or any absence seizure, like when this is happening, and that can be visible with many children.
Right.
When to understand it is critical.
So when these absence seizures, initially they might be just a few in a day. You will just not, you know, observe them. Parents miss them often for months, for years. Right. But then slowly they will become very frequent. The child will have something like 20 to 100 seizures per day. And that is when you will start noticing. So when you think that this is happening very frequently, when you call the child during that time, he or she doesn't answer. He or she is totally lost. They're not even aware that something has happened. If you ask the child that I called you, why didn't you answer? He or she will say that I didn't hear anything. You didn't call me. So when you think that there's a loss of consciousness associated with loss of awareness rather, that is the time to be worried. And if they're happening very frequently, you know, you see the child all the time, he looks like he's or she's daydreaming, then that's the time to be worried.
Okay, so there is a question from Ashima Khurana. She's asking murmuring while sleeping and teeth grinding at night. What do you call it?
This is normal behavior.
Normal.
Yeah, it is normal behavior. So murmuring while sleep is normal. A lot of children do that. Teeth grinding is something which is known as bruxism. So there is a common misconception in society ki ye pet mein keedon se hoti hai. And children keep on getting anti-helminths for months on end. It is not connected to any keede in any way. It is just a sign of stress, anxiety, boredom in the child. So if the child has some stress or anxiety during the day, it will manifest as teeth grinding at night. No treatment is needed. It doesn't need to be treated. It will go away with age. If it happens a lot, like the child is doing it for hours on end, there might be some consequences with the teeth. So you might need to see a dentist. If it happens for a few minutes or a few seconds, sometimes nothing to do for it.
Okay. Now, there's a question from Sanjeev. He's asking, my son is 15 years old. He lacks concentration in studies and uncomfortable in writing long answers. Is it normal? I think it happens to many.
Right.
So he lacks concentration in studies and uncomfortable in writing long answers.
So there can be a few problems which can be associated with it. One is something which is known as ADHD. So attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. And hyperactivity may not occur in it. It might just be ADD. So that is one thing that we are looking for. Second is something which is known as learning disability. So specific learning disability. The child will only have problem with supposed writing or reading or maths or something like that. Third problem is that the child has intellectual disability. That means their IQ is a little low. Everybody cannot have a very good IQ. Everybody cannot be very good at academics all the time. So for this, you need to see someone and then you need to go to a psychologist for a proper testing. So usually we test for ADHD, learning disabilities, as well as IQ. Full scale IQ. So that will give us the answer. The treatment for this may be medication in case of ADHD, and the child might need therapy and special education.
Okay. Any kind of food pattern does influence this kind of behavior?
So there are a lot of things that people say about food patterns, but honestly, none of them have a very great, scientific basis, and in the sense that They have not been conclusively shown to be helpful in improving the behavior. So people do things like, you know, a fat-rich diet, an Atkins diet, a GFCF diet, but scientifically would not be able to recommend anything unless the child has a documented allergy or something like that. There are many medications such as nutraceuticals which are available, which do help a little bit practically, right? But as such, it is not possible to recommend a specific diet pattern. Just give a normal balanced diet, no fancy things, just normal dal, roti, sabzi, chawal, food, fruit, salad is enough, I think, for every child.
Thank you, ma'am. And there's a continuation to the question of earlier. Jawahar is asking, does this abnormal behavior have link to urination on the bed as well, particularly when the child is
I think you're talking about nocturnal enuresis. So nocturnal enuresis is something which has many, many causes. It can be related to kidney, it can be related to surgical problems, it can be related to constipation, it can be related to behavioral problems. So if I talk about pediatric neurology, then there are a few things. Then some medications can cause this. Rarely there might be a surgical problem, something like a meningomyelocele or an overactive bladder, which may cause this. And thirdly, children with ADHD, they may have increased risk of having nocturnal enuresis. So if you feel that, I think your child has nocturnal enuresis, the person to see is a pediatric nephrologist, and he or she will be able to guide you in the right direction because there are multiple causes associated with it.
Right. Ma'am, while we are going through the children or this kind of concern, the biggest question, why it happening? Why these kids are getting this kind of challenges?
Right. So I just spoke about it a little bit in the beginning of the session. So as I showed you a number of movements which are normal, they are physiological, they happen because without any reason, they are developmental and they go away with time. Then there are some movements which can happen due to metabolic disorders, hypoglycemia, lack of calcium, things like that. They can happen with neurological problems. They can happen with autoimmune problems. They can happen due to infections. They can happen due to developmental disorders. So there is no single answer to this, right? So many, many things can cause this problem. And sometimes we don't even have a cause. So they can be idiopathic. Sometimes even after extensive investigation, we are not able to find a cause, but we are able to treat it. So there is no single answer. And I know it is a little confusing. I showed a whole range of movements, but that is the beauty and the difficulty of pediatrics. We deal with patients who are, you know, just newborn kids. They're not able to do anything, but we are dealing with patients who are young adults, 18 years old. So obviously when the development is going on, a lot of changes are happening. So it's a little confusing, and there is no single answer to this question.
Absolutely. And that's the reason it is very important when the mother don't see a great answer. It is important to see the red flag, whatever is concerning you, and reach out to the doctor and save time. That really helps.
Yes,
and exactly. While we are trying to give you a lot of answers related to your concern, we are also doing a lot of initiative for the well-being and wellness of our children. And we are all going through an unprecedented time. But on 21st is International Yoga Day. And on behalf of I'm the Best Mom, I am requesting all the parents to be a part. Please ask the kids to be a part of the Om at Home a yoga, which is happening. And we are going to complete the first year and 21st of June. So please do enroll your kids for the certification program with, we are doing it in collaboration with FIT India. It's a Government of India initiative. So 21 days yoga certification program for all the children in collaboration with FIT India. And this is from 4 years and above. The kids can learn it every day, 30 minutes. So 21 session and 21 asanas, improve memory, concentration, physical, mental well-being. And these are all the benefits which the kids are going to get. So please encourage them to spend, because they are not able to go out as they used to, but let them get the benefit of Om at Home. So it is there. And for more information, you are most welcome to go to the website of I'm the Best Mom and see in detail about the event. Ma'am, we are so thankful to you for addressing and bringing this topic, which is going to help many, many parents. And we would be love to see you in some other episode in future. So thank you so much, ma'am, for your valuable time. And thank you so much, all the attendees, for putting your questions and getting it answered from Dr. Meenalkar. Thank you so much, Dr. Meenal. Any message to all the attendees before we sign out?
When in doubt, see your doctor. And when in greater doubt, see a specialist. It's easier to treat something which comes to us very early, easier to diagnose, easier to treat. And as time goes on, the options may decrease for us.
Absolutely. That's what we have to be careful. Thank you so much, doctor. Have a wonderful night.
Thank you.